This is dead stuff. You buy it in packets. Kmart have got it. Might have 10 bunnies. You can get it anywhere. Buy it in packets. It's you, what you get in the packets is usually dead. Although if you leave it in the sunlight with a bit of water on it, it's just about to start growing. There'll be spores in amongst that might start growing again. It doesn't matter. If you leave that exposed to light, it'll go green. And it'll develop a bit of mould or a bit of fungus, or it might even just start growing as sphagnum moss again. So it's another reason to keep it covered with black plastic. So that'll make one little tree, and then I'll just trim them off in the shape and develop my tree that way. And I'll just remove the branches as I want to get the tree that I want, the shape that I want. So it's quite a nice shaped tree. I'd make a cutting out of that. A piece as thick as that, a pencil thickness or thicker, you want to actually make an aerial layer is probably better. Cuttings will grow, but they're less likely to take off as easily.
I just thought with this one hanging down, I could make
You can make a cascade. Yes, cascade. But I could put an aerial layer there, and I'd have a cascade to start off with.
Yeah, that's what's the...
If I want thicker, I could keep that little section as a cascade. I could put another aerial layer up here and have another tree there. I could do a dozen aerial layers on this one tree.
You can do another.
I can do another layer below, down below that. So long as there's a decent amount of foliage on that section below it, I can do an aerial layer below that. And I can do two or three aerial layers in that section as well. So long as there's a decent amount of foliage on it. This is copropeat. It is coconut fibre ground up into a powder. It usually comes in a brick. I've got the bricks in the car, I didn't bring them in. But it makes a really good rooting medium.
And it's easy to split.
Yeah, you can see from... And you can just plant it like that, with all that stuff on it, and the plant will just love it and just keep growing. And you can see there from that, you've got a nice little miniature tree already from that one cutting.
Is that the same?
And how old is that cutting?
Yes.
How old is that cutting?
How old is this cutting? It's probably not all that old. I think I did this about winter.
Okay.
They've actually overgrown in the pot. I need to have repotted them years ago, or months ago actually. So I brought them in so that people could see what they would look like.
Just in that
copper piece. Wow. Mind you, I do. Look, you see the roots on that?
Wow.
That's a great little tree.
And that's a cutting, just a...
Yeah, that's just a simple cutting.
A stick in the ground.
Just a stick in the ground. I do use the strike cutting, powder on the bottom of a stick.
Do you just dip that in?
Yeah, I just dip it in, yep. And I'll knock off the excess.
Now the cut, is it on an angle or a...
Straight across.
Just straight across.
Even the little one like that. Can you see how well it's taken?
That's even taken.
And even that one,
yeah.
It looks like it's nearly dead, but it's still got good roots. And it's got little shoots coming down below as well. So I might pot those up later. This one, this is actually a Seiyu elm. It's the smaller leaf Chinese elm. Actually, it's a Japanese elm. But you can see from the root system on that, it's growing really, really well. In fact, it's sometimes pretty difficult to get them.
So you're making a lot of work for yourself here.
You've got to be up till midnight repotting.
You've got the pots here.
I've got the pots here, I'll do them later. But just to see that there's good roots on all of these. And it's not always easy to pull the roots apart when they've got so much.
Yeah.
I'm totally enjoying this.
Well, I've got enough here so that everybody can go away with a little cutting if they want.
Beautiful.
Okay? So there's some nice little trees in that lot. Mind you, check out the difference in the roots. Brown roots, white roots. That's off this thing, which is a weed that grew up in the pot.
Oh.
Okay. So sometimes you have to be able to distinguish between the right roots and the wrong roots. Stick your cutting in and then top it up. Simplest thing in the world to pot something up. You don't even have to press it down. Just knock it a little bit. and that should be fine. If you put top it up to right to level to the top and then knock it down, you'll find it settles down to just the right depth to have enough water holding capacity, to enough level to hold water to water the plant in. Okay? Two parts, bluestone screenings, road gravel, the fine 7mm road gravel. To that I add fine crushed pine bark, one part of that, one part of potting mix, and half a part of animal manure. In this one I've actually got dynamic lifters, pellets. I didn't have any cow.
Would native plants not like the dynamic lifter?
Native plants don't mind.
Don't they? Yeah. Some native plants don't like
Nice small little stems there, so I'll take those ones off. Take it down to that one. Just clear the area where I want to do it. Yeah, it will be. It'll be a small one. Take that all the way around, all the way down to the cassia. Just going to mark it where it is so that I know. Do it again on the other side. It doesn't matter really how far apart, but as I said, 1 to 2 inches on average is a good distance. If the stem is narrower, and in this case it is fairly narrow, keep it a little bit less distance. Now, this is the area where I always cut myself. But if the trunk's done right, it will just peel off almost by itself.
Do you expose the whole area?
Yes.
So, the bark though, that's the living part, wouldn't...
Both sides are living.
Yeah.
The bark has the green section underneath it, which is a cambium layer.
Yeah.
And the outer covering. And in between, there's a section where it brings nutrients down from the leaves to the roots.
Yeah.
This section has an upward flow only. This heartwood brings stuff up from the roots to the leaves. It doesn't go downwards.
Right.
That section there underneath the bark goes up, goes down, and it goes sideways.
Right.
So it feeds the plant in every direction. By taking that off, you're depriving...
So you're driving nutrients directly to that point, and then does that cause the roots to start to grow?
Yes, you're driving the nutrients to that point.
Yeah.
They don't have anywhere else to go, so they keep...
They build up and then they just...
And they produce.
Ah, so this is essentially ring barking it, isn't it?
Yes, I am ring barking it.
Right.
So you're actually stressing the plant, and then the plant will go into a growth mode, won't it, when it's stressed, because it wants to survive?
Yes, it is stressing the plant. It's also, by using the rooting hormone, it's encouraging to use the nutrient that's coming down to produce roots.
So how important is it that you make sure there's a complete section that's clear? It's very important,
isn't it? It's very important.
Right.
If you leave a section like that on, that'll keep feeding it up this way and down this way,
right,
and it will discourage the roots from growing.
Right, okay.
And it will start to heal over.
Yep.
So you have to take it all the way off.
So you've got to get the green section out from underneath the outside layer.
Yes.
And the bark.
Got to get the bark off and all that green section underneath as well.
Down to the
heartwood.
So you should be seeing what, yellow?
You should be seeing the yellow wood, no green section.
No green section, okay.
It's a little bit difficult when you've got a lot of little branches and nodes.
Yeah. Do you just snap the nodes off?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You can just leave those off like that and it'll be fine. It doesn't matter if it's nice and clean cut at the top. It's better if it is, because you'll have an even rooting all the way around.
Yeah, okay.
If it's a jagged section at the top, you'll have roots going down lower and roots up higher, and it'll look untidy when it comes out.
Underneath the cut, so that you have
got somewhere where you can tie this up. Just gather it around, overlap it a little bit, and grab a bit of paper tie or some green tie, and fasten it. Always start from the bottom, little hollow, sphagnum moss, squeeze the excess water out, but keep it fairly moist. So that's how moist I keep it, but if you look, I squeeze it, that's got a lot of water still in it.
So what's in the sphagnum moss mix?
The sphagnum moss mix has got Charlie Carp, Maxi Crop, and a liquid hormone.
Hang on, so
something like plant starter.
Are the first two fertilizer?
No. Oh, yes, they're a type of, actually more like a soil conditioner.
Yep.
If you don't have plant starter or a hormone liquid, what you can do is get Vegemite, dissolve it in a bit of water, warm water, and mix that in with it.
Okay. I feel as
some empty jar. Vegemite has got vitamin B, thiamine, ricin, you know, all those sorts of things in it. But the vitamin B is the active thing that you want, which also will encourage roots to develop.
Now, is it important that the host tree is still kept in good condition while you...
Yes. It is very important that you don't let the host tree dry out, that you don't forget to water it, that you keep those leaves green on the tree as long as possible. For this reason, it's better to do it in the spring when you've got lots of active growth on it, rather than in the autumn when the leaves are starting to die back.
And would you continue to feed the tree?
Yes. Feed the tree, water the tree, keep it growing as vigorously as possible.
Okay.
The faster the tree grows, the faster the roots will grow.
And how do you know if this hasn't dried out? Do you have to water that?
Check it. Usually you see humidity, moisture building up underneath it. If there's no moisture building up underneath it, if it starts to look dry, and you can see quite obviously because it goes a lot paler, then make sure you open up the top, put some water in it, make sure it's well soaked in, because when it gets dry, completely dry, it's hard to re-soak the water into. So make sure there's water back into it, and then tie it up.
How often would you check that per week?
You can probably, depends on the temperature. If it's really hot days, an extended period of hot days, check it every week, every fortnight.
Mm-hmm.
With the weather we've had lately, which cool and damp, you don't need to check it as often. Once a month if you need to, just to check it for water. Or just automatically give it a bit of a spray with water. And some people actually leave a bit more space and keep it looser at the top, an open funnel, so they just water it as they water everything else. And they water the plant, they water the cutting.
So the next step, is it important to use the plastic bag first, and then to put the protective covering?
Then you get a black plastic around the top, the outside. If you don't have a black plastic bag, you can cut a plastic pot to go around it to keep it dark. Either will work. The black plastic is more flexible and it's easier to use.
Okay.
But you just keep it dark to keep the light out of it. It just makes it easier to...
So just layering it with that plastic and then the black plastic as well, does that help to keep the water in there?
Yes,
that, right?
That will.
Okay. So
hopefully, if it's really tight down here, the water won't drain down the trunk.
Yep.
It'll stay in there and it'll stay moist. It will evaporate as it gets warm and it'll... Just soak back in again.
So is that why you don't just use straight black plastic? Because it's not as flexible as that?
Straight black plastic will actually get too hot.
Right.
It's not as flexible.
Yes.
The other thing too, you need to keep it growing vigorously, but don't keep it in hot burning sun.
Yep.
So if you're doing it during the spring and you get a 30 degree day, take it out of the sun and keep it in the shade, because when you've got black plastic around it, that'll heat it up and it'll burn any roots that are developing.
Yeah.
Okay? So that's the other thing you have to be careful of.
Aerial layering. Thank you very much.
That's okay. While you're at it, I'll show you one other thing. We'll start down here. Oh, this will do. If you wanted to get a different species and grow it onto another tree, what you do is bud it. And this is the method to use for a rhodal bud. What I've done is I've cut a horizontal line across the bark, about half the width. Then I've cut a vertical line down from that horizontal line through the from the centre point down for about an inch. Then I'm getting this budding knife. Sharp blade on that side and a rounded tapered curve on this side. That tapered curve will allow you to figure out where I'll put my cut. That's the cut there.
Easy to see.
You put your cut thing underneath there and gently lever the bark away.
Could you use like a butter knife or something?
You could use a butter knife, any knife that will work. You need a sharp knife for the initial cuts.
Yes.
So you basically open it up like that. Then you get a piece of... What I'm doing, this is a little bit thin, you really want to use wood that's larger than this. Be careful with the button, if the butting knife is very sharp, you don't want to cut yourself, but it's not going to work there. So what you want to do is take the knife down underneath that bud, take it off, remember which way is up, which is that side, slide that bud into that slit, and it should be wider than that, but it will slide right down. You might have a little bit sticking over, so cut that little bit off.
Wow. So you got a, you essentially got a different branch.
You can put a different species onto the tree with a bud like that. Once you've got that done, you just grab your budding tape.
Budding tape?
Budding tape.
Yes.
It's a soft, clear plastic, very stretchy. Usually put it down there, put that piece up, put that over the top of it to hold it into position, and then just wind it around so that it overlaps itself. Goes all the way up, covers the bud completely.
Covers
it completely. And is tight enough so that water can't get into it. Then you just take that end, tuck it underneath it, and just pull it tight. And there you've got a bud.
Wow.
You can do it. That's the way that's done with roses. And roses are usually budded in February. They take a rootstock, they'll grow it on from spring, from winter actually, when the cuttings are taken, when roses are bare. Take the cutting, stick it in a pot, grow the roots on it. Come February, it should have a really good root system, and then they bud the species that they want of rose onto the top of that cutting.
Could I use that technique to grow branches of different colour maples?
It can be done that way. It's possibly easier with the maples to actually graft them than to bud them, but you can try doing the budding.
Okay.
I know.
How much damage will you cause if you mess it up? Will it be noticeable?
It will leave a bit of a scar. The worst, you'll have a round oval scar where there's no bark. But that should also, as the tree grows, it'll heal over and cover it, so you'll have a round scar. But that's about it. It won't severely damage the tree.
But for maples, if I wanted to do different colour leaf branches,
yes.
You reckon grafting would be better?
I reckon grafting would be better. Now, grafting, probably the easiest way to graft it would be, you want, again, fairly thick material. When I'm grafting, I will actually make a cut down in the tree.
Yep.
That's what I call a side graft.
Yep.
Take a piece of the tree. What you want is a wedge-shaped piece of wood. It's hard to show it with a thing as small as this. And where that frayed edge, you really don't want the frayed edge of the water. But something like that. So it's a cut on both sides, mm-hmm. and so it should be a wedge shape. Then you just slide that wedge shape down into that cut.
Very nice.
And it should hold itself there.
Budding tape.
And then get your budding tape again.
So no chemicals, nothing.
No chemicals, nothing on this one.
Oh, okay. Now, the budding tape. Do you want that watertight seal again?
Yes, you want that watertight seal again. You take it all the way up, over where it's cut. Sit it fairly close and tight to it. You can even take it down again, and then you just tuck it underneath and pull it tight, and that will hold.
So what about the water running down into this join here? Would you
it's not significant enough to worry about.
Right.
Okay. It will just keep it a bit moist. It's not going to worry the plant. Sometimes if you're doing it, say, with a pine tree, you can get an ordinary black pine and bud a very small needle variety of black pine on. They'll do it the same way, but then they'll get plastic and they'll cover the whole lot over to keep the moisture in around that top. With this thing, well, I'm not going to worry about that because it's just a demo.
Yep.
But you can do that. You can get a piece of plastic and just cover over the whole lot and keep it nice and moist.
Right.
And give it a better chance, and that also will keep the moisture out, the water out of it.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Beautiful.
Okay. So that's the other way to do it.
All right. Thank you, Maxine.
Rightio.
Take that one off.
Okay, my reasons were better taper on this. This, if we go with this is the front of the end of the curve, come in this side. So I can't see what I was going to point in front of you. So So if you go,
I mean, these bottom branches ago, they're just going to be
this one does a bit of a double thing. Not that impressive. So I don't know, I think that comes off at a nice angle. You can do more with it. You can actually come back a little bit than that way.
Because it's still young.
Only thing that makes him like this one a little bit better is he's got a lower branch down there.
Yeah.
So you're going to need, but he's going to start up there.
Yeah.
But if you remember this one, these three branches you're going to look at.
Yeah.
Talking about the young.